to be a little bit more precise about what I do today, at work level, I'm still, even if I'm not so young, working in a lab named the Orange Lab. You know Orange, the telecommunication company, which is a very big company. It's like Deutsche Telekom, Telefonica, or these kind of big things. And in those company, you have a research and development section, if you want. You have people doing research and development. And of course, research and development are different. Development, it's more finalized, is how to parameter, for example, a mobile phone network or whatever. But you have also people who are really at the edge of the academic research. And I'm part of this side of the R&D. And more precisely, I'm in a very little lab, which is a social science lab, which is quite specific. We have 3,000 people in the R&D in Orange. And in those 3,000, only 30 are in social science, which is 1%, which is normal because it's a technological company. But we have this small lab, and more or less all of us, we are also teaching, as David was telling, in the field of internet and society, how the digital economy, digital technology, participate at the transformation of our societies, the public space, the governance, but also the economy, the way in which when you are building your identity through the social networks, for example. We are doing all those things, including the big data. I have a big research on the myth and imaginary of big data, these kind of topics. That's my teaching. And I am doing those teaching in several universities in France and in engineer school as well. What I will talk about today, it's not my classic teaching. It's a little bit different. First of all, I have to tell you that if I am in social science, I'm not at all specialized in economics. David is, but not me. Meaning that I'm happy to have you two as discutant more in this field of the economics than me. And what I do, it's a sort of mix. I come more from political science, a little bit of sociology, let's say social science in general. Because when you look at digital and society, internet and society, you are in the obligation to talk a little bit about the history, about the sociology, a little bit about economics, but really at the edge, political science as well. It's a little bit what I do in my teaching. That's why I'm really not an economist. And be sure of that, and don't be surprised about the way in which when I present the things. What I want to start about is the concept of green economy. I will be very short because you are the two and we will do the job in less than 1 hour. But green economy, it's a relatively new concept. It was presented in the international conferences of the UN system in Rio de Janeiro in 2012. Meaning 2 years ago. It's really yesterday. And it was promoted by different international institutions, the World Bank, the OECD, and inside the UN administration, those topics were discussed and presented. To be honest, it was not really, even not at all, supported and promoted by the business sector. The big corporations are, in general, not so happy with this idea. But at the same time, this idea was not accepted easily at all by the civil society, by the activists, by the environmental group. And in the critique of the green economy, I'm sure that you will raise those issues. The concept of green economy, I will explain where it's come from. It's very simple, even if you will be much more precise than me. It's the idea that you have a lot of services, and really key for the economy. Other issue. When you are doing a business, whatever, building,
construction building, these kind of things, you have a very strong emission of green gas, of carbon gas. Those things are a real problem. As you know, climate change is one of the main challenges for humanity. But the constructors are not paying at all these emissions of green gas. That are all the roots of the concept of green economy, is how to internalize, to take a cost and to give a cost to those services given by nature and to let the corporation pay. You understand immediately why the corporations are not so happy with that. And it's not their priority at all. In particular, in a moment in which one today, the economical crisis is still here, the economy is not booming at all, the situation you all know. That the roots of, and the beginning of the discussion about green economy. Now, what's interesting for me is to go a little bit farther in the history and to understand what happened when we talk about nature and when we talk about, let's say, economic, even if I'm not an economist. You remember that the Conference of 2012 in Rio de Janeiro was named Rio Plus 20. Why Rio Plus 20? Because in 1992, you were most of you just born, in 1992, the UN organized a huge conference in Rio de Janeiro named the Earth Summit. Was the beginning of the discussion, not the beginning, but really the highlight of the discussion of environment and politics, what to do about environment. From these 92 conferences, two tracks of negotiation were created, were set up. The first one is all the biodiversity with the Nagoya Convention. There is a long track of UN discussion about biodiversity. But the other one, which is much more well-known, is all the track of the GMO, for example, Europe being more or less an exception, and a big privatization of the seed, the species, and all those things. In the other side, the wild nature were seen or was seen as a place where you have to protect them and also to study them, with the attempt, of course, if you can have a sort of patent coming from the free wild nature to use it in the cultivated area, but with the idea of a clear separation between what is cultivated and what is wild. That 92. We could say that 2012 is the attempt to integrate in the global market the wild nature. That is the basis of green economy. To be very, very schematic. But that will be your job in now a little bit more than half an hour. Now, what I want to discuss is why this conception of a nature divided in two blocks was so easy to implement. Why it was so easy to say that you have the cultivated nature, we name it culture in general, agriculture or culture, as we are doing here, and why the rest was seen of wildness. The wildness are the national park, are the Amazon forest, the mountain, and all those things. And the humanity decided in 92 to have this clear division. And what's interesting, and that it's a little bit an ethnologic or anthropologic analysis, is to understand what could be the relation, and that's my second issue, between human and nature. This relation, in a Western viewpoint, it's our viewpoint because it's becoming now the common viewpoint, it's very clear. In the culture, human being culture, you have the human who are the possibility to exploit the nature. And you have a human which is above the rest of the species, above the nature, and in a sort of dominant position. Historically, it's relatively new. The first one who created, if we can say, this idea, this conception of the world, this vision of the world, it's Descartes, the French philosopher, when he said, I think, then and I am. Meaning that the fact to be able to have an intellectual thinking as humankind puts you above the rest of the universe and above the rest of nature. This vision, and the guy I am talking about is named Descola, it's not at all a universal vision. There are a lot of other visions of the world, meaning another other vision of the relation between culture and nature. Descola explained that there is mainly four family of vision, if you want. The Western one, our vision. But which is really, and I will describe the other one, very new, is the 17th century. Not before. To give you an idea, you are today in France. I don't know if some of you are French. No? One French. Okay. You have to know that before Descartes, in the 16th century, which is not so old, there was trial against animals. Animals were put, in particular in Normandy, in front of Britain, are put in front of judge, to be judged. Meaning that there is a very nice book published in England, for those of you who are Brit, who is relating this story, how to judge animals. And in France, for example, there was a story of a pig who was running in a village and hurting someone, and this person fell down. He was a prince, he was very hurt, and then he died. They organized a judgment of the pig. They killed the pig, but before they judged the pig. They did the same with dogs, with a lot of animals, meaning that the relation between human and nature was not at all what it is today. Totally different. And that in the country of Descartes, not in the middle of a jungle, in the country of Descartes. That shows how new is this particular vision of human dominating, if you want, the nature. If you look at what Descola was discovering, he said that there is three other visions of the world, or the relation between human and nature. The second one, it's perhaps the most well-known, if you saw the movie Avatar, it's exactly that. It's what we name the animism. If you go in North Siberia, if you go in a lot of places before the capitalism, you have the idea that the spirit is everywhere. Spirit is in the humankind, but also in the animals, in the trees, in the plant, in the air, in the stars, in the moon, everywhere. And this spirit can pass from one to the other. There is a sort of capacity to pass from animals to human. And if you look at the myth of Avatar, you all saw this movie, I'm sure, of Cameron, it's exactly that, how they are exchanging with the spirits of trees, animals, and all those things. Of course, it's a movie, it's not the reality, but this vision of the world is the vision of the animism, which is another vision, totally different than the Western one. The third vision of the relation between human and nature is what the scholar named the totemism. It's something very well known in the Australian Aborigines culture, but also in the Northwest American Indian culture, the idea that you have a class of elements who could be human, animals, or even things, who are above the others. And those ones are interchangeable, meaning that you can be eagle in the Indian culture, you can be a bear, but in Australia you can also be a snake, and the snake is also a river. And this particular class of living creature, but also natural element like a river, are the superior class of elements, that the totemism. And he described the fourth relation between human and nature, which is the more complex to understand, as he named it the, I don't remember the name exact, the exact name will come back, but it's the vision of the world, of the, and it's very important for the next things I will explain to you, of the Bolivian, Peruvian, and Ecuadorian Indians, which is the idea that you have the same level, there is no one above the other, the humans are not above the llama, the mountains, the Mother Earth, as they said in this particular region of the world, the Pachamama, that the name they give to the Mother Earth. But there is no interchangeability. The spirit cannot pass from one to the other. There is a big barrier in between all those realities, human, animals, and natural things. But they are all at the same level without possibility to pass from one to the other at the difference of the animism. That's the fourth vision the scholar described. But what's interesting is to see that this particular separation between cultivated nature and wilderness, it's really the Western vision of the relation between humanity and the rest of the nature. And it was theorized by someone you perhaps know if you are known. You have someone from the state? The US state? Yeah, you know John Muir? The other one probably don't know John Muir. Muir is a guy, he's a naturalist who discovered. A lot of people discovered before him, who was the first Western guy to really describe all the Rocky Mountains. And he was at the origin of two important things, the concept of the natural park, and the Yosemite and all those parks come from John Muir. He convinced Roosevelt, not the Roosevelt of the Second World War, but the first Roosevelt, to establish those national parks. But he also created a very well-known and important NGOs in the US named the Sierra Club. The Sierra Club is really the big environmental classic NGOs close to the Democrat Party, to be very brief. But for John Muir, the wilderness has to be protected from the humans and had to be separated from the human. And there is this idea that you have the world of the human with the cultivated land and all those things, and the wilderness who have to be protected because the human are a danger for the wilderness. And one of the things people don't know generally is that one of the first things the national park did is to expel the Indian, of course, because they were supposed to pollute. The wilderness was supposed to be really wild. Meaning that John Muir, which is a nice guy because he did a lot of good things in the US space to protect the nature, at the same time was really in this vision of a clear separation between human and nature. And de facto, the human was not above because it was seen as bad, but totally separated. When you look at the three other visions of the world, they are not the same. Nature and culture are interlinked, are totally related. They are not separated as they are in the vision of the Western civilization. And that has a consequence, which is the fact that in response, in answer to this concept of green economy, meaning which is an attempt to put the wild nature inside the general capitalist economy, there is another possibility, which is to give to the nature fundamental rights. And the Bolivian state, followed by the Ecuadorian state, decided to present in the United Nations frame a proposal to give to the nature fundamental rights. And that, it's really something quite strange, rather strange for Western people. Because how you can give fundamental rights to a tree, to a horse, to a mountain, to a river? And it's important to understand that because we have in the history of the law system different generations of fundamental rights. The first one, you know it very well, is all the civic rights. The first generation is the end of the 18th. It's the American Revolution, the French Revolution, coming also from the 17th Revolution in Britain. And it's all the right, the fundamental right of expression, organization, all the civil rights, who are very important. The civil right. But you know that during the 19th century, the growth of the working class was coming with an incredible poverty of this working class in Britain first, then in France, Germany, everywhere else. And a lot of people were saying, for good reason, that it's not acceptable to have people sending their kids to work at 5 years and all those things. And there was the growth of what we name now the social right. Right to housing, right to go to school, right to education, right to have access to health service, all the things were what we name now the social right, which is the second generation of human fundamental right, all the social right. And those two rights were codified in 1948 in the Human Declaration of Universal Rights of the United Nations, which is a mix between this first generation and this second generation. Then, in the 60s, 70s, another set of ideas appears. The idea that people, for example, have the right to live in peace, that they have the right to live in a good environment without a huge pollution. All those kind of rights are named the third generation of fundamental rights. But all those three generations, the first, the second, and even the third, are anthropocentered, if you want. Meaning, they're talking, those rights, about the right of humans, not the right non-human. And what the Bolivian was putting on the table is to have a fourth generation of human fundamental rights, who are the right of nature. And that, it's really coming from this particular vision of the relation between human and nature, was not at all the Western one. And the discussion is just starting, but I think it's extremely interesting because that obliges us to see the things differently. Of course, you will tell me, okay, but a tree or even an horse have not the possibility to express itself and to defend its own right. But take it differently. We are not in a law course, we are in economics here. Imagine that we are in a law. The first thing the teacher will tell you is that even if the criminal is the worst one, even if it's someone who had killed 20 babies or horrible things, he has the right to be defended. He has the fundamental right to have a lawyer defending him, even if this guy is the worst of the worst. Looking at this analogy, you can say why the horse, the mountains, the river, could not have a lawyer, someone talking on behalf of them. And that obliged the people who play this role to change the position. You are not only talking about the humankind, but you are talking, thinking at what could be the right of animals, natural realities, and so on and so on. And these things are now shifting, changing a little bit the term of the discussion, the term of the debate. That's what I wanted to present you, because that is really new. It's coming from Rio 2 years ago. It's not a long story. But I think it's particularly interesting, because that changed a lot of way in which one we are seeing the world. And now I will finish, before to give you the floor for the discussion, by a last part of what I want to say, and it's really when I want to ask to the students who are following the Benjamin Coria course to be aware and tell me if it's too boring. It's to realize that with this idea of fundamental rights for nature, you have also the idea of the commons. And this idea of the commons is also supported by the Indian communities in Bolivia or Ecuador. And there is a big discussion now in all the NGO sectors, in all the social movement sectors, about what could be the common. Few words about the commons. The commons are a very, very old issue, even if people didn't name the commons, but it's coming from the history of the humanity. It's the idea that you have a lot of goods who are not private, and they are not neither public, meaning they are not the property of the state, neither the property of Mr. Smith or Mrs. Durand or whatever, or one corporation. They are commons. The commons is, for example, the field of people living in Africa or in a lot of countries where there is no private property of land, but neither state property. The fields are used by everyone with their cattle. The commons exist still in Europe, in a lot of places. For example, I have a countryside house in 200 kilometers from Paris. It's not in the middle of the jungle neither. The wood are part of the commune. And when we need to cut the wood, there is a call to all the inhabitants to take a chainsaw and to go to cut the wood for heating your house. And everyone go together, and it's quite friendly, nice, because it's something you do in common with the community. But these things is here in a developed country. Ahlström, you know probably Ahlström, she's a Nobel Prize of Economy, describe how in Switzerland, which is one of the most rich countries in the world, the farmers are still using the upfield in the mountain as commons. The commons are very old. And they exist everywhere in all the civilization, with different names, but in all the civilization. The idea is that the commons were used as a vision of the economy in the 19th century by the first socialists, or for the first people helping or wanting to help the working class. If you know a little bit the history of the working class in the Great Britain, Owens, who was an entrepreneur, was also the first intellectual leader to really defend the working class and to try to organize the working class. And he did it through the chart, all the idea to have rights for the workers, but also with the idea of cooperatives, that workers could work together in a cooperative. And those cooperatives were seen as the new commons, commons not of farm and field and forest, but commons of industrial realization, of factories. And this idea coming from Owens was the tool, the root and the basis of what was named later on the communism. The communism is the theory of the commons in the 19th century, even if, of course, the history of the Communist Party, the USSR, it's another story. But historically, the commons come from Owens and the people who defend the cooperative in the 19th century. My question was, when I start to look at the commons, why in the history of the social movement, in the history of the left, history of the unions, the commons disappear at the end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th century. All those things dissolve in the air. No one were talking about. Even if the cooperative were still here, even in Switzerland, people were still using commons. In the political wording, framing, the commons disappear. And the left use another paradigm, another vision, which was to nationalize the big corporation and to have a planification of the economy. And the debate was organized in the 20th century between, in one hand, privatization, market mechanism, profit, capitalism, and in the other hand, nationalization, planification of the economy, and that were the two alternatives people were discussing. But the common out. Why that happened at the end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th century? In my opinion, but it's totally discutable, it's because of two reasons. The first one is well known, and probably Benjamin Coria told you that several times, is the fact that the end of the 19th century is the end of the first globalization. The first globalization started to broke really in 1886, the first beginning when Bismarck started to put tariffs in agricultural and industrial goods. But this end of the first globalization take place in different steps until the First World War and even the big crisis of 29. It was not something who happened one day to the other, it was a process. During this process, the power of the states, the big states, Germany, France, Britain, US, Japan, Russia mainly, was more and more important, and the socialism and the left was framed by this importance of the state. At the same moment, a new kind of factory of corporation appears, in Germany first and in the US later. The old capitalism coming from England was a little bit seen as passé, and instead of that, a sort of integrated corporation, the German model, was seen as the best way to be productive, efficient, and to be able to produce manufactured goods in the best way. The Taylorism in the US was finishing this process, if you want. And everyone was in this vision of the world. When you read Kautsky, Kautsky is the pope of the social democracy, he's a German social democrat, extremely important in the social democrat world. If you read Lenin, communist, USSR, everyone knows Lenin, of course, both of them were believing that socialism, the formula is from Kautsky, is the administration of the railway administration at the scale of the society. Meaning a vision of the world which is extremely far from the commons. It's really the state and the big vertical organization of the society. But I have another reason which explains why the commons disappear. It's because those social rights. At the same period, when the first globalization start to decline, the lot of social rights were put on the table and were able to transform the society. Because there was a sort of common need between the demand of the workers, but also the necessity for the bosses and for the state. Two examples, very simple. School. Of course, school is a cost, and the state have to have taxes to be able to pay free school. But at the same time, before the school, the companies didn't have a good trained labor force because people arrive in factory, they didn't know how to read, they didn't know how to write, they didn't know how to understand simple orders. And the fact to have a labor force which is enough educated to be enough flexible in the labor force, it's extremely important. And the boss, were the employers, were extremely happy to see that the labor force will be better and better. It's still the case today. That's why there is a sort of consensus in all our society to have a sort of free education, at least until the secondary school. After that, it's more difficult, depending on the countries. But that is something we made consensus from the end of the 19th century. We could say the same about the health system. Before the public health, the employers had to pay for the sick workers, and that was expensive. And the employers were quite happy to let the state look after that, the church first and the state second. Meaning that things we were extremely important for the workers and for the popular class in general to have their kids educated and to be able to be treated in hospital were seen as fundamental right, but those rights could not be addressed by the commons. The cooperative or the farmers common were not able, of course, to give school system and to give health system. Meaning the state was seen as the best way to give and to afford to have all those social rights. I think it's for this couple of reasons that the common disappeared in the 20th century. Today, the common are back. Why they are back? First, because people are quite fed up by globalization, privatization, inequalities, and all those things. But at the same time, no one believed in the state economy, as the USSR or East Germany or whatever, are the solution. Who wants to live in the USSR today? Frankly, no one. No one, not me, at least. And for this reason, people are looking for other solutions, who are not the free capitalism, a sort of wild capitalism, but neither a state system. And the common appear as something which is really interesting, because it's something who can be more collaborative, more generous than the capitalism, but without being the state. And it's interesting because in a lot of aspects today, you have not a binary choice between privatization, market mechanism, capitalism, private property versus state, public, nationalization and planification. You have a third way. And this third way appears through the knowledge creation mainly and through the nature as well. And I will finish by that. Knowledge, it's very simple. You know all of you Wikipedia. Wikipedia is translated in all the languages of the world, and it's for all of us one of the main access to knowledge. In the secondary school, I'm sure it's true in all the country you are coming from, all the pupils who have 15, 16 years, the first thing they do when they have a question is to look at Wikipedia, of course. But Wikipedia is an extremely interesting thing because it's clearly a common. It's not privatized, it's not part of a big corporation, it's not Google who create Wikipedia, not at all, but it's not the state neither. Wikipedia is not created by the Minister of Education of the US, France, Germany, or whatever. It's done by you and me. Wikipedia is a common. The internet, I will not enter into details, the internet are also common. Is also a common. And you have in the knowledge sector a lot of things who are de facto commons, because they are done by people in a free way. The free software, of course, and a lot of others. But nature also now become also part of this vision. Not nature as such, because commons, it's not a fact, it's not a category. There is not a category of commons. To talk about nature, the stars, the moon, are not a common. They don't care about humanity. It's not their problem. A common is when you have a relation between human and something. Commons are a human relation. And when nature has to be managed by human, de facto they become a common, but only when they have to be managed by human. If not, nature is nature. They don't need us. But when people believe that it's important to manage the water access, to manage a forest, then they become a common. And at this level, you are coming back to this green economy discussion. Because if you look, for example, at the Amazon, you have three ways to look at the way to resolve the deforestation and to maintain the Amazon as a sort of lung of the planet. The first way is what the Brazil state said. It's the state sovereignty of Brazil. Brazil has to express its sovereignty and is the only one able to decide about Amazon. Okay, that's a way which is the national way, public, nationalization, the classic not USSR, Brazil is not USSR, but it's this way. You have in the other side people who say, no, the state is not able to do that. Look at the reality. They are now today cutting the Amazon and they are not able to protect it. The only way is to privatize it, but through an NGO process, by a sort of offset of green gas emission bond, and we can have a sort of good deal between NGOs who are protecting the Amazon against the money given by Air France, Lufthansa or Delta or other big polluters who will export their offset to protect the Amazon. And you have then a third way, which is what the Indian from the Amazon say, that they are the only one able to really protect the forest because they live in, they live with, and they live really in symbiosis with the Amazon. And that shows very clearly that there is the three solutions. Of course, me, I am in defense of the indigenous of the Amazon, and but it's another way than the state system and the sovereignty of Brazil, and they have a lot of shock. The Indians are in Brasilia all the time at the moment to defend their right against the interest of the state, but they are neither a sort of NGO-ish approach using the green economy as a sort of, not exactly a greenwashing because they are more nice than that, but to privatize a little bit the Amazon without thinking of the people who are living in and who are probably the most able to protect this common good, which is the Amazon. That's what I wanted to present you in the time was given to me. And first, thanks for your attention. Two, if there are questions and things like that, it could be good perhaps before you, but I don't know how you organize the yeah, you are the boss. Thank you, Etienne.
Hello everyone, I'm Nutsa and she's Nuoya. We're going to present the topic about green economy, rights of nature and the commons. So, this is the contents list of our presentation. First, we want to describe what is green economy, then moving towards green economy, policy frameworks. Then comes developing alternatives beyond ecological modernization. And also we raise question why you move to a green economy. Then we describe rights of nature. And then comes criticism about green economy, and then green job analysis, and also critics at the end. And then we will talk. We will ask some questions to the professor. So first of all, what is green economy? Green economy is defined as an economy that results in reducing environmental risk and ecological scarcities, and aims for sustainable development without regarding the environment. Also, it means it describes like the link of economic, environmental, and social considerations of sustainable development in such a manner that long-term economic development is achieved by investing in environmentally friendly and socially equitable solutions. And also, under the green economy, it should be achieved resilient economy that provides better quality of life, all within the ecological limits of the planet. So, moving forward, green economy, a challenge in two dimensions. So, under the influence of United Nations, particularly the United Nations Environment Programme, the concepts of green economy, green growth and global Green New Deal have emerged into the global policy debate. It was in 2011. And then green economy is characterized by sustainable increased investment in economic sectors that build on and enhance Earth's natural capital or reduce ecological scarcities and environmental risks. And also there are two challenges of moving towards green economy. This is radically reducing the footprint of developed countries while at the same time raising levels of social and material well-being in developing countries. So, United Nations Environmental Programme. The United Nations Environmental Programme developed the concept of green economy on the argument that recurring energy, climate, environmental, food and financial crises are results of gross misallocation of capital. And according to the United Nations Environmental Programme, it responds to the growing recognition that achieving sustainability rests almost entirely on getting the economy right. So here are some policy frameworks for green growth. First is the pricing pollution and natural resource use through mechanisms such as taxes or tradable permits. And these are amongst the most cost-effective policy instruments, and they incentivize efficiency gains and innovation. Then comes ensuring that regulatory standards focus on outcomes. Regulations that address pollution on the energy efficiency can be important complements and effective substitutes for price-based policy. Also, there is a case of innovation, and it can lend support by funding relevant research, supplying finance tailored to different stages of technology development, and also using demand-side instruments such as standards, regulations, and public procurement. And also, there's case of infrastructure investment programs in sectors such as water, energy, and transport. This means that well-planned programs can help drive development, reduce water and air pollution, and carbon unsustainable land use change, and enable the deployment of next-generation technologies. So these are green-related national programs implemented by selected countries. So you can see the country and the green related national programs according to them. These sources is Chateau, Employment Impacts of Climate Change Migration Policies in OECD countries. So as you can see, some of the countries doesn't have any green related national programs at all. Then comes developing alternatives beyond ecological modernization. First of all, democratizing control over societal nature relations instead of leaving this control to the big capital and its political allies. And then equitable access to the earth's resources and carbon sinks instead of the externalization of ecological costs from the global north to the global south and from wealthier social groups to those who are marginalized. And also there is a question about strengthening the notion of sufficiency instead of focusing on efficiency. And then linking questions that and practices of decoupling with a comprehensive and democratic understanding of wealth, well-being and social equality, and not focusing on economic growth only. And also considering alternative experiences, approaches and concepts in other regions of the world. For example, the case of Ecuador, and I'm going to talk about this later. And why move to the green economy? So from the development perspective, there are a number of ways which a green economy might benefit from both developed and developing countries. First of all, green economy is more than just environmental in scope. It is about the development of the economy as well. And a green economy should not only maintain, but should enhance the value of the poor in developing countries derived from agriculture, fisheries, and forest harvests, all activities that depend fundamentally on the sound environment. Also, it should help reduce energy poverty through the provision of low-cost distributed renewable energy system, and it should help reduce vulnerability of the poor to the impacts of unchecked climate change, the desertification, ocean degradation, and loss of biodiversity, as well as the impacts of local air, soil, and water pollution. And also in developed and developing countries alike, it should be the spur for new innovation activities, which is one of the important issues in economy, activities that create more jobs than traditional sectors and increase energy security and industrial efficiency. So, but there also exists right of nature and in the green economy. So green economy is a strategy that will commodify nature through the sale of ecosystem services and market mechanisms. And right of nature changes the mindset of by granting Mother Earth the right not to be destroyed by human activity. And the first case was in Ecuador, and it's the example of implementing rights of nature. So it's the first country who implemented rights of nature into their constitution. And finally, some criticism about green economy. Using price mechanisms to protect nature. This will extend corporate control into new areas from forestry to water. And also in United Nations Environmental Programme report towards a green economy, it ignores the fact that capacity of existing political system to establish regulations and restrictions to the free operation is seriously limited by political and financial power of corporations. And the green economy, as advocated by United Nations, is not a new approach at all and is actually a diversion from the real drivers of environmental crisis. This is said by Klaus Plesch, an ecological economist. Now Nuoya will continue about Kriti's side and another important issues about green economy.
Well, thank you, Lusa. Thank you, Christophe, for a wonderful presentation. Now I'm going to talk more about critics of the green economy concept. We summarize 10 theses that will criticize the green the fourth green economy concept. First of all, under the green economy concept, it's or under the current mechanisms of capitalism, it's impossible to separate the economic growth with environmental destructions. Second of all, green economy is tried to hide the exploration or the power relationships between the North and the South, and confine the social dimension to economic growth, green jobs, and poverty reduction. Number three, strategies of green economy are based on technological approaches. Number four, green economy is depoliticizing the debate around a social ecological transformation. Number five, green economy is pushing the commodification of natural capital under the guise of protecting the nature. Number six, green economy is favoring market-induced mechanisms. Number seven, while Germany is like a primary example of a hegemonical green economy model. And number eight, green economy is socially and spatially exclusive and selective. Basically means that only rich people and middle classes can benefit from this green economy model, while the poor and the local communities are excluded from this green economic transformation. Number nine, the solidarity of an economy should be based on democratic decisions rather than on the logic of value and prices of the green economy. And number 10, in order to counteract the impacts of this fourth green economy, we should include social movements and civil society to counteract the fourth green economy concept. First of all, the fourth green economy has three pillars. Basically, it's environmental protection, economic growth, and social development. So basically, UNEP is trying to promote investments into these 10 areas to promote interests of big corporations and big banks in G8 countries. That's why this green economy concept got so popular. And so basically, the global laws is trying to export their expertise and services to the South, while exploitation natural resources from the South, and big banks are trying to create innovative financial instruments to formalize a relationship between governments and the private sector to maximize their own profits and interests and to promote competition between different states and different corporations. And when we come to what green economy promises, it promises enterprises will get higher returns from the investment projects that they post, and the South countries can get opportunities in the market from the green sector by capturing the market value of ecosystems. And the green economy tries to voluntarily encourage corporations to invest in projects into the green sector by promising them higher returns. And basically, there's no binding agreements to bind any nation or to reduce their carbon emission or to reduce their original material extraction. All these are voluntary measures. And so think about this green economy. We could basically conclude that this green economy is another concept our financialization process, our financial net capitalism process. Basically, it stresses market mechanisms and market power. So it will promote privatization and commercialization of natural capital. And communities who depend on natural resources for surviving cannot face the competition from these big corporations. It ignores the cultural context usually contained in the ecosystem services, and also it marginalizes the question of social equity. It ignores the problem of redistribution by not mentioning any of these policies in the green economy programs it tried to promote. Also, by subcontracting the green this investment projects to private companies. Basically, the private companies will take the profit in the end, while the public will take the risk. So in the end, the green economy will amplify the social disparities, racial, class, and gender discrimination that we now have, rather than disaggregating these problems. Now, an example of the green economy industry is the bell food industry. We could say that to take control of the bell food industry and the food plants, and also try to promote the genetically modified products. These big corporations such as Monsanto, P&G, and also big pharmaceutical companies, big chemical companies, try to promote their products around the world, while the local farmers try to use their own seeds, cannot face the competition power from these big companies. So it basically marginalizes the local community and the poor people who depend on the local resources. So when it comes to the green economy concept, we go to the Rio de Janeiro conference of 1992. It's at this conference that development as that sustainable development concept got promoted, but after a conference, this concept of development as economic growth never got questioned, and it basically suggests that developing countries should follow the industrial transformation process that has taken by developed nations, but the question remains: who participate in the green economy, who benefit from it, and who what is the redistributionist policies around a country, a region, and around the world? It remains open to the general public. And now we come to the green economy try to use efficiency and technology as a solution to cure all the problems that I just mentioned, such as poverty, social inequality, and employment. So basically, even though since the 1970s, energy intensity and carbon intensity got reduced, but still we have more and more carbon emission, we have more and more natural resources extraction. What could explain that? Basically, the gains from the inputs of the of increases in carbon intensity got compensated by the fact that demand for natural resources increases after price drop. This is called the rebound effect. And now, so we conclude by saying that under the capitalism situation, if we want to have economic growth, we have to continue the current patterns of consumption in the West, and in developing countries, they are also trying to copy this consumption pattern of of the West. So if we do not change the Western consumption pattern, we cannot have economic growth and environmental protection at the same time. Now, after the global economic crisis, nations around the world try to promote this Green New Deal program, by promising millions of jobs and by investing into the solar sector or mass transportation sector or waste management sector. But when we look at into the fact of green, what is green jobs and what are the working conditions for green jobs, we could say that green jobs are quite marginal. It composes only 2.6% in the US, 1.4% in the EU, 5.3% in Germany, and 4.8% in Austria. And the working conditions in these green jobs, such as construction, waste management, or agriculture, are not as good as the green economy promises. Basically, workers face heavy labor and considerable health risks, and also precarious employment relationships. So out of all these green jobs, it's usually male that takes the predominant role, usually female workers. Out of the 26 occupations within a green industry in EU, only three are female dominated. So the female role basically got ignored. And when we talk about the working hours and ecological consumption, we could conclude that there is a small, when we increase a worker's working hour by one per week, we will get a 0.32% increase in energy consumed. And when we look at the comparison between United States and Europe, we could say that United States usually have more workers in the United States work average 10 more hours than workers in Europe. So, and in the end, US stand number 2 in ecological footprint. And now basically I come to the conclusion that in order to counteract the effects of this false economical concept, we have to take into social movements and take into the interest of local communities, and by including the civil society that we could counteract the effects of this false economic concept. Here come to our questions. Well, first, who controls the green economy? Second, sustainable development or green economy, is it a question of political will? And third, current climate during the current climate change negotiations, it's basically about technological transfer from the north to the south. And do you think developing countries can sacrifice their economic interests for a green transformation? And my fourth question, because I'm from China, so I ask, like in a hegemonical power like China, how should local communities protect their environmental interests to counteract big companies and sometimes state power? Well, here comes our references. Thank you.
Thank you very much, first of all, Professor. I really like the historical approach towards it and how you put everything in perspective, even for my own thinking. I have three questions to begin with, and we'll come back to more. Is that some parts of the presentation, both, I mean, yours and the discussants, that I felt were not elaborated enough as to the point that they were making. First of all is, how does the Green Economy Initiative, a move to privatize the wild nature, as you called it? And secondly, I did not understand that what are these rights of the nature? And finally, how is it a financialization of nature, for that matter? I mean, it's similar to the first one, but I think the discussions went pretty ahead with how much of a financialization process it is, and if you can kindly elaborate. Thank you.
Okay. I also have a few questions. I don't know if I'll be able to get them straight in my head. But anyway, One of the things that in the article, in one of the articles that we had to read for this presentation, it talked about how we should resist the tendency to try to value natural systems, right? We should resist the tendency to try and put a price on a tree or whatever. But how do we protect these things in the current system as it is without giving some physical number to them, or I guess numbers are technically imaginary, but how do we, since that is our mindset, how do we convince people that don't necessarily see the value in nature without using a numbers concept? And so in that sense, do we need more of like a, is this like sustainability movement more of like a spiritual movement that we need? I guess I'll let this go to.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your presentation. Very interesting. I have two questions. The first one is concerning nature in its smallest form, as we know. And considering your presentation, I suppose you're not a fan of patenting genes. And it was patenting genes and... Patenting genes. And I was wondering, do you see a role for commons or the theory of commons on that, in that sector, and how the development in this field is supposed to go on? And the second question is related to my country, because I'm Dutch, and we have a political party called the Party for the Animals. I don't know if you heard about it. And this party is kind of, okay, the image of the party is very much that they're defending the rights of animals and fish in a fishbowl, and okay. But actually, if you look at their party like proposals, they're the only party, at least in the Netherlands, which doesn't have like the human at the center of their vision. But I think they have a very strange, or maybe the image of the party is not very well conceived. And I was wondering, well, first, if you know the party, and second of all, how we can avoid this image of kind of standing for the animals, but not in a more encompassing idea. Thank you.
Thanks. This is linked to the notion of having nature, and it's quite related to Barbara in a way. Barbara's question is like the notion of having nature and other living species to have the rights to be defended. It's something that I'm supportive of, but then I'm not very familiar with this topic in the first place. But is this actually happening currently, for example, in Ecuador, since Ecuador recently introduced the rights of nature in their constitution? So do we see this in Ecuador? And also, if not, what are the possibilities of having this notion in reality? So if nature or even other species have the rights to be defended, would this require some tweaking in the jurisdiction or legal infrastructure of a country? Thanks.
I have a few questions, but I'll ask one. Given that from a post-Keynesian perspective, financialization is lowering real investment, what do you see as the connection between financialization and environmental degradation? It's a bit of a dangerous relationship, I'm suggesting, because with the reduction of real investment, we're technically reducing the pollutions and emissions, but I wonder if you have more to elaborate on this. Thank you.
Thank you for the presentation. I actually have a bunch of questions, but I'll narrow it down to two. My first question has to do with common property rights. I would like to say that I'm a strong believer of that. And in the context... Common property rights. I'm a big fan of that, and I think that in the context of urbanization and the problems of climate change that are becoming more and more apparent, how can we assure that common property rights are dealing with protecting nature but also providing an income for people that are involved in these common property rights or that are involved in trying to protect certain natural resources from being abused? Is it possible? Is it possible to come up with a wage prosperity in the context of common property rights, particularly in cities? My second question is, basically, the paper that we read does not mention enough about waste management, and I think waste is one of the biggest problems of climate change. Do you think it's possible to incorporate a sector that deals with waste management? So, for example, when people are done using their products, they are able to contact different companies that deal with what to do with these waste products and sort of foster innovation in terms of managing the waste so that it doesn't go straight into the environment and coming up with byproducts that could be of value in the future. Do you think that is possible? And I actually have a comment about that, or maybe a question. The durability of products, I think, is something that needs to be more emphasized in our consumption mindset. And instead of having to always buy the cheapest product, you know, at a very fast rate, is it possible for companies to emphasize on their products being extremely durable and potentially having different divisions within the company to make sure that that product lasts longer and thereby, you know, deleting the mindset of continue buying and rather just preserving the things that we buy? Thank you.
Okay, first of all, thanks for the presentation. I have a curiosity and a question. The curiosity is, like, I would like to know if you know what were the reactions to the Bolivian proposal of moving. What were the reaction when Bolivia proposed, let's say, the international elite to create this fourth generation of social fundamental rights? And my question is has to do with education and what could be the role of education, especially primary education, in changing this Western vision of the role between human and nature. And I'm thinking of an example which I recently saw in a documentary. It's this school in Bhutan where basically equality and sustainability and preservation of nature, these values are at the core of the curriculum. So do you think this could be viable in Western countries and would it be effective? And if you know, are there any examples of this? I'm thinking of Scandinavian countries maybe, but I would like to know.
Thank you. My question is regarding when you go to the sphere of real politics, because yeah, it's true. Ecuador was the one who started implementing the idea of the Wembivir and Pachamama in his legislation, but then again, they were also the ones who are drilling Yasuni. Yes. So in reality, they are promoting all this, but they are keeping their tradition of exploitation of natural resources. And actually, it's a shame that they are trying to present something in the international sphere, but they are acting in a different way international. And also, we could see that there were a lot of opposition from the indigenous population in Ecuador to Correa's plan. So what happened when you really face this sphere in politics?
Okay, thank you for the presentation. My question maybe is a bit related with one of my friend, Ana Sofia. I wanted to know, okay, about if you think that commons may be a new way to manage nature according this new perspective of nature. Like, do you know if first if you can maybe provide us some example of commons, of successful commons? And if not, maybe if you have an idea of what could be like the next step. Okay, now we have this idea of new right, but then what should be done in order to actually pass to a more operating way of managing nature through common? So, thank you.
I have actually a question about the green economy issue. Like, I saw you're also a researcher in information technologies. So from your perspective, what's the connection that you see between the green economy and the pursuit of knowledge economy here in Europe? I mean, is there any connection, is positive, negative? And on the question of commons, somebody asked about the financialization of natural commons. So from that point of view, what is the role of government in this, the role of government in the financial, the role of government, the role of government in the financialization of natural commons? I mean, what is the role governments are playing right now? And yeah, what kind of role would you expect them to actually play in this whole regime?
So my friends already asked a lot of interesting questions. I just wanted to make a comment about the idea of separation of human and nature in the Western philosophy. You say that it dates back to Descartes, and it's true that in Descartes, such as in the treatise on method, there are quotes such as mastering science enables us to be like masters and possessors of nature. So there is a theory of that in Descartes, but I think that the distinction between human and nature is both more deep and more ancient than that. For instance, in Aristotle's physics, because in Greek physics means the science of nature, he defines nature by what has in itself the principle of its own movement, as opposed to what humans do, like, I don't know, construct a house or make science. It's from a human will to do something that nature wouldn't have done. So I think it's really deeply rooted and more ancient than Descartes. But at the same time, in the 16th century, there was Descartes, but there was also Spinoza, who theorized the idea of unity, the unity in what he calls God or nature, and in which there was not really a distinction between human and nature, but there is no free will. So we cannot have the will to decide what we do, no more than a stone which is falling because of the forces of nature. So maybe we can draw more inspiration from Spinoza and less from Descartes to design what to do with between human and nature.
Thank you very much for your presentation. I also had a lot of questions, but now it's not going to be possible. But rather, I'll ask you, when we look on the green economy issue, we have the developed world and the developing world, and apparently, the developed world developed using fossils based energy. They used coal and now we have the developing countries who are being pushed towards a green economy, and that's very expensive. And you still have coal, which is very also cheaper and also readily available. So how do we balance these needs that the developing countries, they still need to develop, and what is not so green in terms of energy could be cheaper to help these developing countries to develop? And then another question is to do with the role of finance in supporting our green economy. I follow a lot of our renewable energy sector, and one of the best performing companies so far in expanding the use of solar energy at the level of household, it's called Solar City. It's an American company, and what they've essentially done is that they have securitized the solar technology, and by that process they've actually managed now to put so many households on solar. And to what extent can then that become an issue in terms of when we look on issue of financialization? How can we keep the use of finance in advancing or in bringing about the use of solar systems, for example, or just renewable energy technologies at large? How can we control the use of finance so that we don't have the same scenarios of bubbles or over-financialization of the sector itself? Because it is also true that finance is helping to expand the adoption of our renewable resources. So how, if you may comment, how can we probably bring that on check and avoid a bubble, for example? Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Another question? Yes. Hello, I'm Jana, I'm from Ukraine. And what I wanted to say, because I was born in USSR, and I'm thinking, because I'm following Koryat's lectures, and I think it's a little bit misleading notion that socialism causes pollution, or caused pollution in all post-USSR countries, because for me, I would say communal ownership was very good managed, and especially in agricultural sphere. But what about, for example, pollution? For example, in USSR, it was tradition. They called it subotnik. It's like every Saturday, all people were going outside and they cleaned the street. So I would say, actually, this is misleading notion, because people were responsible for environment. And for me, the only, I cannot say drawback, but like a bad thing was, I think it was a lack of the government control. But for me personally, it was not a problem of socialism.
So just to add to your long list of questions, Professor. I'm thinking, after listening to all the questions in the floor, I should probably mention that I've worked on the Green Economy Initiative with UNEP in Geneva, so I kind of know as an insider that what is the alternative, if not this? Are we going to start philosophizing about the, you know, different forms of visions of human and nature relationship, or do we have something practical for now? And I mean, I'm no advocate of green economy, but I see it as an immediate, an answer to your question, that it's an immediate measure that you can take. Secondly, important thing to keep in mind is that the developed countries, which are now developed, grew without any environmental sustainability constraints, and suddenly they want the green economy, you know, to be the benchmark, and are telling the developing countries that, all right, you have to grow sustainably because it's bad for the environment, bad for the earth, etc. And the Green Economy Initiative has seen like tremendous opposition from the developing countries in particular. I was hoping you mention it, but yes, from NGOs, from activists, but nothing like the policymakers from the developing countries. So in that sense, there are a lot of the criticism that I saw was unfounded. And the question of finance, for example, I mean, any initiative would need finance. Where would finance come from if you have to shift to greener technologies? Now, the technological know-how is in the developed countries. What the developing countries are saying in the international forums is that, all right, you want green economy, then transfer the technology at lower prices or fund our initiatives. And the European Union, to an extent, is doing that. They're in the second phase of the Green Economy Initiative. I know of three projects in Peru, Ghana, and one more country, and two more coming up. But they plan to extend it to the rest of the developing world as well. So how do you see all of this in this light? I think we need to keep the green economy in the center and, you know, structure our debate around it. Thank you.
Sorry.
For the discussion, okay.
For the discussants, I noted that on your 10 theses, which you elaborate, rather you didn't elaborate, but which you mentioned, you spoke about Germany being a typical example of the hegemonic control of the green economy. If you could explain further on that. And then the other point to do with, you also said green economy tends to create, like selectivity or exclusion of some sort, if you could explain that. Though I, my opinion is that in terms of Germany, it's a country which has actually presented a very viable model in terms of how we can use renewable energy, for example. Though, of course, there are still some challenges between especially in biomass, there's a challenge between do we grow crops for energy or do we grow crops for food? And then you have this kind of trying to find a balance between the two. But nevertheless, I think Germany have also presented both at government level, at policy level, a model which can actually be emulated by other countries. They've allowed the sector to grow to the extent that even the Asian are actually giants in terms of investors. They are now actually coming to buy into German models and bring it to China. And that goes also to one of the discussants point. Actually, China is leading in terms also of greening up its economy, but mostly at the household level, at the community level. And no surprise, the only billionaire in the world right now is in green energy is actually from China, because they're adopting these technologies and they're using them at household level to allow where you can't have traditional system of electricity running. Then you have solar system, we have biogas stoves or biomass systems as well. And on social exclusion, I'm not so sure, because in the African context, for example, we don't have so much of a connection on the national grid in terms of electricity. So actually we are using most of the renewable energy technologies to bring electricity. Biogas and solar system, they're actually allowing those who actually initially socially excluded in terms of energy poverty, they are now have electricity at home, they can cook, they can have lights in their house. So if you may probably tell me something else different on your points of social exclusion, and also on why do you think green economy is a hegemon in Germany? Thank you.
Okay, and Christophe, since you maybe don't have enough question to speak until midnight, so I add my own question. Maybe you could tell us a few words about what the social movement, how the social movement is organizing now his struggle, and what are the key focuses for social movement, how they organize also, because they participate, part of the social movement participate in the conference of the United Nations as NGOs, civil society organizations. So maybe try to do the link.
Okay, I will try, but also let you answer to some question. I will try to not forget some of the question. If it's the case, no problem. Raise your hand and insist to let me try to answer. To try to organize the answer, I will start by the philosophical very quickly. The idea that Descartes was not the first one to create this separation, what you said, which is absolutely true. You find in the Greek philosophy what you were exactly telling. But what's interesting with Descartes, even if Spinoza was different, is the fact that he was the first one to theorize something which became a sort of unique vision of the world, at least in the West. And little by little that happened, meaning that all the people here were born and trained in the Western world have this vision inside themselves, because it's part of the education. And why Descartes was able to be so to have a so big impact, it's also because at the same time, or few decades or one century later, a lot of big separation happened in Europe. In particular, the big separation between science and politics, and science and religions. Those things are good, by the way. I don't want to see the religion in the science. I don't want to have in a course someone telling me, you know, that God created the earth 5,000 years ago with Adam and Eve and all those stupidities. I don't want that at all, not be worried. But this big distinction reinforces the Cartesian view, because, of course, science was separated from politics in theory. And you have very nice books if you are interested on those things. One of the most funny one, his name is the Leviathan and the pump à vide, the pump, the air pump. The Leviathan and the air pump. It's the debate between Hobbes, you all know Hobbes, the Leviathan, and Boyle. Boyle is the creator of the Royal Academy of Science of Britain. And it's about the air pump. It's possible to have empty space or not. And this discussion was the beginning of the separation between politics and science in the case of Britain. And all those things reinforce Cartesianism and explain why it's so embedded in us, this vision of the world.
Sorry, just to follow up on the same one, yeah? Because it's going to take like an hour, yeah, before we come back to it. Obviously, I'm not French, and I mean, I don't have this very deep understanding of French philosophy, but from what I understand, the context that we studied, I think, therefore I am, was a question of existence and not nature and human relationship. Why do we exist? And the question of human conscience, the fact that we have conscience confirms that we exist. You know, for example, animals don't know that they exist because they don't have this.
It's discutable.
I mean, I'm sure they don't.
Yeah, all those things. Only thing I want to say. Yeah, of course, now, which is also in the Cartesianism, but what I want to explain is this vision of the world was stabilized through different kind of mechanism, and not only because of the thinking of Descartes, but also this big separation between science, religion, politics, all those things who create the modern science, the modern politics, and the beginning of the Enlightenment. You are really at this period of the history of ideas. Second things, still a little bit in philosophy, if you want, the right of animals, what you say. It's an interesting issue because, of course, in the Western world, this problematic of right of nature didn't arrive from this kind of Pachamama, Mother Earth, Indian, Bolivian, Ecuadorian story, of course, because it's another reality. But that's arrived through a very simple thing. Can you beat your pet? Can you kill your dog? Can you all those things? And it's interesting because it's related to violence in society, in fact. I am totally convinced, and we could have a long discussion on that, that more a society is non-violent, more a certain number of things are impossible, and for good reasons. For example, it was not so long ago that men could be able to beat their wife, not to kill them, but to beat them. That is, of course, not allowed in most of our countries, but not in the rest of the world. But forget the woman and man relationship, look at the kids. Look at the kids. Even in France today, it's allowed to beat your kid. It's allowed. There is a discussion starting because the family minister wants to pass a law forbidden that, which is the case in a lot of other countries in Europe, in particular in all the North Europe, it's not allowed. And I totally supporting of that. But here it's still allowed. In all South Europe, it's allowed. If your kid is naughty, paf! No, it's shocking for you, it's shocking for me as well. But you have to know that it's allowed. I'm not telling that all the parents are doing that, but it's allowed. And more you are seeing a little bit the Scandinavian model expanding on women first, and perfect, of course, on kids now starting, but there are a lot of resistance here. If you read French, David can tell me, there's a lot of people saying, what, are we passing a law about beating kids? Let family do what they want. You see what I mean? The right parties are really against this idea to regulate what kind of level of violence is possible in a family. And of course, when you start, wife, kid, and pet, and animals in general, and you have a big evolution in our society to regulate that, which is another way to take the problem. Me, I didn't know that there was a party in favor of animals. It's quite weird, in my opinion. I'm not really supporting that. But the interesting thing is to realize that the relation we have with our environment in general, it's moving. And it's also an answer to you to this idea that the only way to protect nature is to give price. I'm not convinced on that because I'm sure that the fact to care, which is not a price, you care about human without giving them a price, I hope. No, I'm sure about you. But we care about people without having to tell, you own 1 million euros. It's not the point. You care. And you can care about a lot of things because it's part of your childhood, of the things you love. And it's another way to see the world and to live in the world. And I'm sure that without being religious, you can have this vision, and if movies like Alien were so popular, it's also for that, because people feel this need to be more in peace with the environment we are living in. If you look, for example, at what the Bolivian and the Ecuadorian were telling about this idea of buen vivir, living well, it's also an idea which is growing. You have other concepts, the concept of the care, which is also a little bit this idea to have a more peaceful and respectful relation with your environment without having to monetize, financialize, and all those things. I'm quite convinced of that, at least at personal level.
I'm sorry, I totally believe that as well, but my question was more, we exist in a society that has institutional structures that don't allow for that kind of thinking within, and how do we, as people that want to protect the environment,
yeah. Yes and no, because we are in a society, you are totally right, in a world in which one, the attempt of, let's say, capitalism, to be brief, we can discuss what kind of system, but capitalism wants to merchandise, to make everything become a merchandise. That's obvious. But the strengths of the resistance are totally amazing. Look, for example, at the free software. Free software were developed because the software was patented in 82 by Bill Gates and Microsoft. Before, the software was not patented, and there was no free software movement. The attempt to patent created immediately a reaction with the free software movement. And if you look at the story of the software, today the free software won. The battle is already won. It's done. Most of the software are free today. And the patented software, it's a finishing world. Even Microsoft will be, in 5 years, I can guarantee you, will be one of the champions of the free software. They are transforming their business because they are losing in front of Google for pure competition, not at all because they are believing in the Red Cross or whatever, because of the capitalist competition. And in this capitalist competition, you can have space for free software, which is a common. That shows that the things, of course, capitalism tries to make everything as a merchandise. That's for sure true. But at the same time, the reaction of the society are very, 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 very strong. And the way people care about their environment. Look at the number of urban struggle. Look at the Gezi Park in Istanbul. Look at all those, the transport issue in Brazil. In China, you have an incredible number of struggles to defend the environment. People refuse to be expelled for whatever stupid big project. You have everywhere this kind of reaction. And it's of course, it's a tension, it's a struggle, but that exists. And we are not only living in a sort of merchandising way. And you have a lot of proofs and roots of resistance to that. I am quite convinced of that. I still go on about commons and profitability, income, all those things. The problem of the term of commons, there are a lot of different things under the name of commons. What's common between Wikipedia, cooperative, field in Switzerland, the water management in Oasis, the things are so diverse. For me, there is only one common thing in the common. It's the fact that if you don't care about, they die. To be very concrete, Wikipedia. You know Wikipedia. How many people here had at least written one sentence or one word or one comma in Wikipedia? Only two? Hey. Now, who here have already written one word or one sentence in Wikipedia? Who wrote in Wikipedia even a little bit? One, two, three? You wrote in Wikipedia? No, we are two. Frankly, it's an incentive for you to do the same, do it. Because what we know about Wikipedia, and it's true in all the comments, that if no one cares about, they will die. If we stop to write in Wikipedia, Wikipedia will become the property of a private company or a state realization. The comments exist when people care about and look after. That's the common things in all the comments, wherever they are. If you don't look after, if you don't care about, they die. But after that, there are a lot of different realities. Some of the commons are extremely profitable. I will give you an example that could look strange, but which is really a common. You all know the champagne. You all drink champagne. The name champagne is a common. The name Coca-Cola, it's a brand. Champagne, it's a common. What is the difference? Coca-Cola, there is a company named Coca-Cola who own the brand Coca-Cola. And it's a private property. Champagne is not a private property, it's a common property. Meaning that there is an agreement in this region around Reims, in the east of France, whatever, which is a strange agreement between huge companies. If you look at Mouette and Chandon, all the big names, they are incredibly rich corporations. They are not at all nice NGOs, and they are super rich corporations. But you have also all the farmers. And they are generally quite little. And they pass all the time an agreement about what quality of the grapes, what size of the field of champagne, what price of the grapes given by the big corporation to the farmers. And all those things, it's a way to protect the quality of champagne. And that's a common. But I can give you an idea, you know it, that the income of the people in Champagne is very high because it's super, super profitable. But it's a common. That's the big difference between Coca-Cola and Champagne. Because it's a common property of a community, of the people living there. And there is, in Europe at least, I'm not telling in the rest of the world, a lot of battles to extend this notion of common to the name of things. Look, you know all the feta, this Greek cheese coming from chips. Feta was at the beginning a generic name, as the champagne. You had champagne from the US, champagne from South Africa, champagne from everywhere. And the feta, the main producer of feta was Denmark, which is quite strange. The Greek fight, and they won, the fact that the feta has to be done in Greece by the Greek community and the Greek ships. And I think it's good, because it's a way to reclaim power to the community, to give to the people at local level the way to control what they are doing, and also to get an income, meaning that you can get money with. You have to.
Yeah, okay, based on this idea of commons, do you think that a place that does not necessarily have to do with natural resources, for example, cities, can have this notion of profitability? Or is it just about maintaining neighborhoods, infrastructure, of course, schools, like different services that people need to live when they're congested with each other?
I'll tell you 2 words about a city. You want to tell something?
I wanted to add something about champagne, but already now, because of the profitability of being able to call their wine champagne, for the same like price of a bottle, the exact same wine done in the next region in Alsace, for the same price, is going to be a much better quality, because champagne is it's a signal of luxury and it means something to people. But already now in Champagne, in the region, they produce so much grapes per square meter that the quality of the wine is not as good as in other regions that make wine with the exact same methods.
But it's very interesting, because if they don't care about, and again, the common you have to care about. If you don't care about, the champagne will drop. Look at another common, Bordeaux, another big French wine. The Bordeaux wineyard, the people, didn't care really about. And the Bordeaux became, frankly, what we name in French a piquette, meaning a shit. And they were losing. Now you can find in supermarket Bordeaux at 3 euros, 2 euros 50. Because they destroyed, if you want, the value of the commons, Bordeaux, because they didn't care. And in Champagne, it's true that the quality could be discussed, but the point of the common is to maintain a certain level of quality, because they are wine. And that is to care about, to look after, to be responsible of. And this responsibility, caring, looking after, it's absolutely key, it's the essence même. Even of the commons. That's only what I wanted to tell. But then the commons are so diverse that someone asked me about seed and common. I don't know who, or agricultural realities and commons. But, in the commons, one of the complex things that commons are not always public. Most of the commons are public. If you look at the free software, for example, the first rule of the free software is public. And the general public license, that the name of the license will protect the free software. General public license, meaning that it's open, you can look after. But in the farmer world, in particular in the seed world, the people who reject Monsanto, but also the imposition from the state to have a sort of very classic, clean seed of wheat or whatever, always the same, and people want to have local seed of apple, for example, to have different varieties and so on, they don't want to give it as a public knowledge. They want to exchange it with the people they trust. And there are a lot of different relationships. I will not enter into the details, but there are a lot of different relationships about that. Waste management, city, and so on. City, it's a very important issue. And you have a lot of new struggle. I was giving two or three of those examples, but you have a big concept was created for part of from people for created by people from New York, like the right to the city. You know perhaps David Harvey? Yeah. David Harvey, it's a very famous, he's the most quoted geographer today. If you are in the field of geography, David Harvey is one of the superstars. He's a British but living in the US and teaching in New York. And he was one of the theorists promoting the concept of right of the city, which is not exactly a common, it's right to the city. And there are urban struggles who are now creating movement fighting for right to the city. Through this concept of right to the city, you have this idea that the city is also a common. And then you have a lot of discussion in the theoretical field about what is to be innovative in city. You have people, other theorists, you know, perhaps Saskia Sassen, who wrote Global Cities. She's a sociologist, an urban sociologist, American, Dutch at the beginning, but living in, teaching in the LSE and in Chicago. And she created this idea of hierarchy of city in a globalized world. The idea is very simple, is more the world is globalized, more the state are less important, and more cities are key. A little bit in like in the 15th, 16th, 17th century in Europe with the Hanseatic League and the Italian Republic, who were trading together in the... It was a down of capitalism, if you want. And we are coming back a little bit to this kind of hierarchy of cities, which is quite unfair, because of course you have the New York and London, we are the two dominating cities, and then a hierarchy of city. And you have other theorists, I don't like him in the sense of I don't like the value he's promoting, like Richard Florida. I don't know if you saw this book, is the rise of creative class, all the concept of creative class. All those things are very discutable, because it's a sort of relegation of the workers and the production, the industrial production as a sort of shit from the backyard. And the good thing is to be creative, and you put in the same bag Bill Gates and a grapher who is living with minimum income. There are a lot of things to discuss in Richard Florida. But you have a lot of theories about how to make a city innovative, profitable, and so on. I will not go further on. I give you two, three names of things to read, even if they are really discutable, in particular Richard Florida, in my opinion. But whatever. At least it's a way for you to know what are the roots of the theories on those fields of city. Now, about two things more, and then I will let you speak, and if there are other questions, we can discuss again. About right of nature, the reality of politics, what's possible to imagine as a achievement of right of nature. Of course, I agree with you. If you look at Bolivia and Ecuador, and it's also an answer to your curiosity, there was a big change. In 2008-09, when they arrived, they really promote a new model of society, give a lot of power, and that's still the case in Bolivia. Ecuador is more complex, but still the case in Bolivia, a big revenge of the Indian communities who were really more than marginalized. Don't forget that 60 years ago, 17 years ago, to 70 years ago, in Bolivia to vote, you had to be able to read and write in Spanish. Or the Indians, you know, it speaks Aymara and Quechua, no Spanish. And of course, they don't write and read Spanish, which is not their language. Meaning that by this simple law, the Indians were excluded from the vote, which was a guarantee for the white to have the power forever. That's changing very quickly, in particular in Bolivia. And it's an extremely good thing. It's a little bit like in South Africa, is the arrival of the majority. It's really the beginning of democracy. But those things are good. But at the same time, those powers, the Korea and Evo Morales, were really promoting the idea to have an ecological state. To be honest, that was not very long, 2-3 years at the most. You had people like we were talking about Pablo Solon, who was the ambassador of Bolivia in the United States system, was the guy who would promote and propose these human rights, fundamental right of nature declaration. But then it split with the government. There was a big split in Bolivia, and it was also a big split in Ecuador. Meaning the real politics is not so nice today that it was 5 years ago. And to answer to your question, of course, everyone was quite surprised when they received that. Bolivia is still a very respected country, a little bit like South Africa, for the same reason, because at last the majority was able to win the power. The Indians, in the case of Bolivia, but I think they forget to look really after this declaration of right of nature. It's something which is on the table, but not really discussed today. But at the same time, if you look at a huge long-term fight, look at slavery. The humanity was based on slavery for millenniums. And the first one to reject that were at the end of the 18th century, but not the Enlightenment. We are talking about philosophers. Most of the enlightened philosophers were in favor of slavery. And we need a long time to have the evolution of our society. I think the last country to finish with slavery in America was Brazil at the end of the 19th century. That showed the time needed today is more a new concept. That's why it's interesting. The reality of politics is messy, not so coherent, Bolivia, Ecuador. But at the same time, now there is something changing. There is a new vision which is emerging and which is really promoted by a lot of people in a lot of places in the world. I want to finish a little bit by the concept of green economy that you will be able to talk about and the fact that it's perhaps the best possible. Paradoxically, I think that it's very important. That's why I wanted to talk about that and I proposed those texts and so on, because to come back to what you said, there is a big attempt of capitalism today to put the market everywhere, to get price and to give price to everything and to merchandise everything. That's universal. And that's why it's interesting to discuss also about this financialization of nature, because that is the point. At the same time, except the most crazy neoliberal, but everyone knows that a market exists only when you have a police and a tribunal. Without police and without tribunal, you don't have a market, because you need to have rules. And someone, which is the policeman, who say, hey, you are not respecting the rule. And that's true in all markets. That's why, for example, in the free trade market between the US and the European Union, this question of who will be the tribunal, where will be the tribunal, and what will be his role, and so on, is so sensitive and so political, because it's a key issue. Today, in the case of green economy, financialization of nature, and in fact the climate change negotiation, because it's inside the climate change negotiation that the discussion is the most advanced, the carbon market and all the price on nature are declining, not as idea, but as reality. I explain myself. You need to have a real market, you need a police. And the police can come only if you have a binding agreement. It's what exactly the US and the EU are discussing in this free trade, to have a binding agreement. In the case of nature and green economy de facto, but also carbon market and climate change convention, the US will always refuse any kind of binding agreement. That's not discutable for them. And they are still the main superpower. Meaning that in the new trend of negotiation, going from New York in September, you know that there was the Ban Ki-moon summit on climate in New York 2 months ago, it's clear that we will not have a real binding agreement in Paris in 2015 and neither wherever it is 3 years later. They are all talking about different mechanisms. One of those mechanisms is name and shame, and it's what Barack Obama wants to propose. Name and shame, meaning that every country will present his commitment, and if he doesn't reach it, it's shame on him. I'm not telling that it's good or bad, but it's what the US administration is now promoting and proposing. In this system of name and shame, or whatever the name you give to this system, there is no possibility of a market. Because there is no binding agreement, there is no police, there is no tribunal, there is no arbitration. Then the World Bank understood that quickly, because they have good good analysts and good economists, and they changed their view. In New York, they published a paper, And they say, what we need is to give price to the carbon. Whatever you want to organize it, it's your problem as country. And what the World Bank is promoting is the idea that you have to put price on carbon and to fix the price as you want. If you want to have a local market in the US or in the European Union, it's your problem, do it. But if you want to have tax, do it as well. Meaning that this idea to have a global price of nature all over the world, being a sort of standard as the dollar is the common currency all over the world, that will never happen, at least for the next 10, 20, 30 years. Because that's require a binding agreement, and that will never happen, at least in the predictable time. Who knows what will be the world in 30 years. But for the next years, that will not happen. Meaning that this financialization of nature will be a real discussion, but more region by region, country by country, European Union inside, these kind of things. It's more at this level that the discussion will come. But at the same time, the concept is quite strong. I finish and I will give you the floor just after that about USSR. It will be a long discussion, but I agree with you. I think that, of course, the USSR regime was quite polluting, to be honest. When you look at the factories and what they did, the atomic power, all the waste and the atomic powers and all those things, it's enormous. But it's not intrinsic, if you want, to the regime itself. And you had in the USSR, and that's why I insist on this idea of caring, looking after, and so on. A lot of things were this kind of reality. And what you explain about the old people every Saturday cleaning the city or their village is exactly this idea. You had much more solidarity and common caring that people imagine. It was not only a police state, even if the police was there, of course, that's well known, but it was not only that. It was also, and if you look, for example, I don't know if there are German in the room, you are German, all the East German nostalgia, same thing. People believe that first they are now not respected and treated like a shit, but also that we forget, of course, the police, the horrible dictature, it's not at all to support the East Europe, East Germany regime, but you had a sort of solidarity between families, local neighborhoods, communities, much stronger than today. And that, it's related, I think, with what you said.
Just going back to the legally binding agreements to control or to put a price on nature. This is by no means enough, like what I'm going to talk about is by no means enough to address the issue of carbon emissions. But do you think the recent agreement between the US and China, for both, you know, since they're both the largest polluters in the world, do you think that agreement is a step towards, you know, coming up with a legally binding agreement in the future to, you know, put a cap on emissions?
But if you want to say something about the, and then we'll follow.
Nolan, in order to answer a question about Germany as a hegemonic power of the green economy, I mean that Germany is trying to promote this green economy concept because it wants to promote the economic interests after it rather than promoting real protection of environment. For example, the green car industry. Why promote the green car industry? Because manufacturing of cars is a strong competitiveness of the German economy. And also, when it comes to try to get cheap energy, it can form a cooperation agreement with one of the Middle Asia countries to get the cheap natural gas. But this Middle Asia country is quite is run by military, so it ignores other factors such as promotion of human rights or promotion of the environment, while it tries to promote its economic interests. It set up several large wind farms after the Fukushima accident in Japan, but it doesn't like promote any real social or social ecological change. It just, did I answer your question? And also when it comes to marginalize the poor of the green economy, how it marginalizes the poor. I have two examples for you. For example, in one of the green ecological investment programs,
promoted by South Korea to invest in building dams on one of its rivers. Usually building up dams comes up the relocation of local community who lives in the downstream of a certain river. So the communities who depend on natural resources have to relocate, and what they get is only like really small amount of compensation from the government. So they don't have the means or the community that they used to have before relocation anymore. And second example is that the developed relations usually try, in the industry of waste management, your developed relations try to export their medical waste to developing nations. So do you think that people in these developing countries should suffer like this medical waste that these developed relations can't process? That's one of the two examples of how the poor are suffering from this green economy.
Are these green economy initiatives, did you say?
No,
it's happening, and green economy is trying to value it.
Yeah, I mean,
you're confusing something here.
I mean, in the green investment projects promoted by the developing nations, it's trying to separate the waste, but how do they deal with the waste that they can't process? And how do they deal with the carbon they can't process? In this carbon trading process, they export the carbon to the south. They buy the carbon from the south.
Okay. So problem is that there are institutions.
We can take maybe all the questions and all the answers. So maybe you do you want to add something or Nutsa? It's okay.
Who
has questions so that we, how many, just a few last questions if you want, but not so many, because time is over. Okay, so can you take the microphone for the, okay, so not so long question?
Okay, if you can kindly go back to the previous 10 thesis of the green economy. Okay, so thesis number one, green economy says exactly that economic growth and environment destruction cannot be separated. I don't see how it is a criticism of that. And keeping that in view, it is trying to promote a model which is economically beneficial to, particularly to the developing countries, but still is sustainable. Because developing countries would never accept it, you know, because they need to grow, just like Nolan said.
Sorry, I didn't get your point.
The point is, on what basis is that a criticism of the green economy? I mean, I can point four more, I just don't understand.
That's a question, on what basis?
For me, it was just, I just asked about education earlier, so.
Yeah.
Education, the role of education. I was curious about your idea.
And about what do you think the relationship is with financialization and the real economy, and what does this mean to the environment?
Christophe, you missed a few questions.
Yeah. I got the one from Spain, but maybe some example which is more in the direction of not damaging nature, or maybe that was implemented as a result in South America.
Common in nature.
Yeah, common in nature. Like an example of common.
And you are acknowledged. I want to make a comment that much of the green economy drive is also based on marketing and a way of putting your image differently. For instance, most of the leading, some of the leading enterprise like Google, for example, is now run on fuel cells, which use water and natural gas. But that is nothing more to do with the green economy. It's like fair trade, for example. It's not so much to do with the green economy, but how the company will be seen by its customers, that this company is green. Or Walmart, for example, is also run by fuel cells. So there's also that kind of probably an unfortunate thing that when we should be pushing the issue of our green economy for its sake and its actual benefits, you also have the capture of that concept by business or enterprises, and then they use it to boost up their own image in the process. Thank you.
just because my question is related with the education, because in Scandinavia, the society works really different. Like in Sweden with the Allmänskolan, it's just a different approach to it. So also I think those countries work differently because there's less population, but with more population growth in the world, do you think it's possible even for other countries to educate kids or educate the society and work like that?
Mm-hmm. I try to answer the last question very quickly because I totally agree with you. It's what is named the greenwashing, and you have that everywhere. Of course, in the green economy, but everywhere. You will see during the COP conference. The COP is Conference of Parties. The UN Frame and Convention on Climate Change is the place where the people negotiate the climate change issues. A lot of companies are there, and they are all more green one than the other. You have the green Mercedes, the green Volkswagen, the green Renault, the green whatever. But it's really pure greenwashing. I totally agree with you. About education, I'm not sure to be the good guy to answer. It's not at all my field. My impression, but it's more an intuition than a real knowledge, that there is no reason why it's possible in Finland, Sweden, and so on could not be extended. Of course, the societies are little, but by kid, the cost is the same. Then when you have bigger societies like Germany, France, or much bigger like the US, why not to use the same methodology? I'm sure that in France, we have a lot of things to learn because our system is this class, for example. I was teaching this morning, and this class is much more vibrant, living than most of the French class. David can tell that as well. Because here, students are good. I'm not telling that the French students are bad, but they are more used to listen, to take note, and ciao, and not really to engage, as you do. And it's good. And you are right, much more than us in France. It's not at all true. But that shows that it's possible to change the system. And I'm sure that we, in France, for example, we have to learn a lot because our system is quite elitist. If you are good to swallow hundreds of hours of magistral teaching, perfect. You can finish at normal superior and be part of the elite. But most of the kids don't like that, and they are a little bit put on the way. Meaning that we have a lot of things to learn, but I will not be more long on that because it's not at all my field. Two other answers about the concrete example of common and nature, there are a lot. Historically, there are a lot. For example, look at Oasis in the limit between the Sahara and Northern Africa, the management of water. It's extremely important. It was always a common, meaning that everyone knows that this family had the right to have half an hour of water, this whatever, and they all organize that together. They maintain a very small dam, because it's not big dam, but very small. And you have a lot of examples, I will not enter in all those details, who show that works very well. All the economical theory, the Hardin's theory, which the name is The Tragedy of the Commons, you probably know that because it's a quite classic article in economy. You have a lot of counter example who show that it's not the reality. The reality of the commons is it's a common management of resources. And Ahlström demonstrated that very well, and there are a lot of articles showing that. You have example of Oasis, example of the field in the Alps, in the mountains. You have a lot of examples. Today, the main challenge will be to have worldwide or very big commons like oceans, about fishing because there is a scarcity of fish, atmosphere and carbon gas. All those things require a sort of common discussion of the international communities, in which when you have is the question of David, not only the state. If you look at the UN discussion on climate change, it's what they name a multi-stakeholder discussion. In the UN system, you have the state, but you have a lot of constituencies. Those constituencies are the environmental NGOs, the labor NGOs, who are the unions de facto, the corporate NGOs, the companies, the local authorities, and all those people discuss together because you cannot advance in such difficult issue if you are not able to have a sort of trans sector approach. And the civil society is extremely well organized on the climate issue, through the UN system, because everyone met every year during the COP and know each other and are able to exchange arguments. And what's interesting also is the way to take a decision is very different than the way we generally use in the classic democracy. In democracy, we vote every 5 years or 4 years and whatever, and then that's done. And we wait 4 years more to vote again, and that's it. In spaces like the climate negotiation, everything has to be decided by consensus. Even in the scientific field, you know, all the IPCC, the International Panel on Experts on Climate Change, all the report, the last one was published this year, all those reports are done and written by consensus with hundreds of scientists. It's absolutely enormous. And it's the same rule than in the information technology world, in the internet world. You know that the internet, the governance of internet is done by consensus, and the laws who are produced in the internet are the same than in the climate. It's what we name the request for comment, which is very interesting because it's totally different than the way we are generally creating laws in our countries. To create a law, you go to the parliament, you have a deputy or a government proposing the law, you vote its majority, and the law is for everyone. In the case of the internet or the climate, the laws is a request for comment, meaning it's a call to discuss. Meaning that if you have an argument again, if you have a good reason to oppose and to discuss what we are proposing, tell it, and we will discuss about. And this kind of request for comment and consensual way to decide, it's a very different approach. It's quite long. If you look at climate, we are far from achieving. In the case of internet, that works well. Open your computer, you will see that that works. But in the climate, it's more difficult, of course. What I believe about the China and US agreement, I think that, it's good that at least they talk together and start to say things. When you look at the reality, it's extremely poor. It's extremely poor. It's far away from what the scientific consensus require or ask to decide today. And no one wants to have a binding agreement. They want to, what they want is to say what they will commit as state, as government, not to have a signature on the treaty, which is binding. They refuse both of them that. In particular, the US, but China, it's quite happy to avoid also the binding agreement. Now, money, and I finish with that, because of course, developing countries need money. But to imagine that this money will come from a sort of green economy, carbon market, and so on, I don't believe that will work. And I am really much more in favor of the Green Fund, that mechanism where the northern country, the people, the state, who are in fact responsible of the climate change, because it's not Africa or Latin America which is responsible of climate change, it's Europe, US, Australia, Japan. And those countries have to contribute to help the developing country. And of course, there is a lot now, every country is telling what he will give and so on. I'm quite suspicious because we have to be sure that it's real money and not only a loan, but a real gift. We have to also to monitor to be sure that this money, it's not only an exchange between the money they gave to government for X or Z reason to the Green Fund, but in my opinion, it's the best way to give resources to the developing country. And I'm also in favor, and I finish with that, to finish with patents, to let, at least in the renewable energy sector, the capacity for the developing country to do the same thing than in drugs and pharmacy for... That's it. I'm not sure that we have so much time.